This is the last day of what has been already a pretty successful week for Milken, starting on actually Saturday night, as Michael said, and then carrying through this morning. So I want to congratulate you. You're here early on a Wednesday. That shows you've got the initiative to stick through this. And as I always encourage the Milken crowd, we've got to end strong. We don't peter out at the end as we get tired. We end strong and finish through the finish line. So congratulations to you. Our panel is about reading the tea leaves. So we're going to tell you what to buy and what to short tomorrow in the markets to make money. But I do want to start the panel by a very honest opening. My name is Chris Ailman. I am the Chief Investment Officer for the California State Teachers Retirement System, CalSTRS. I led this panel in this room a year ago on this day, and I would be want to be honest to tell you that if you had taken the panel's advice and gone out and done the opposite of what we said, you would have doubled your money. The panel was on Europe, and everyone was adamant that Greece was coming out of the euro, and yet if you had bought Greek equity or Greek debt, you would have doubled your money in that time period. Pretty interesting perspective. So, but this panel, we've turned it around. This panel's got it right, so don't worry. But I want to introduce everybody really quick. Their bios are in your book. Ann Casscells is the CEO and co-president of Aetos Alternative Investments. John Rogers over here is the founder and CEO of Ariel Capital. You'll know them because they're always famous for their little turtle icon. Slow and steady wins the race. John Calamos is the CEO and chairman of Calamos Investments. And George Evans is the CEO and CIO of the CIO of the non-US growth portfolio for Oppenheimer. And Todd Morley is the chairman and CEO of G2 Investments. So we're going to start from the US perspective, go through the US, then talk about rates, and then go to the global perspective. And I really challenge the panel to get into a give or take. We've heard here over the last 3 days that obviously we're in the middle of an unusual period of quantitative easing in the US, in Europe, and in Asia, particularly or in Japan. When will it end, and how will it end? Is it going to end badly or end smoothly? So let's start with the US and take a look at the question of kind of, are we in this new normal or is it the old normal? And I'm going to ask if we can start with Ann.
Okay. I guess I am an advocate of the new normal. My investment views tend to resonate somewhat with those of Muhammad El Aryan at PIMCO or Ray Dalio. I think that the U.S. has been transitioning, as Europe has been, into a slower period of growth that is largely driven by demographics. As the country has aged and we have fewer working age people, I think we've been transitioning from a 3% growth environment to a 2% growth environment. And I actually think part of the story of the 2000s was that we tried to cover up that slowdown in growth through a lot of leverage, and we've come a cropper on it. So I believe we're in a 2% growth environment in the US. I actually think in Europe, where the demographic and other problems are greater, they may be in a 0% growth environment, which is quite difficult. And I think we're also probably midway through, or a little bit more through, a 10-year deleveraging period, which we're handling reasonably well in the US. It's what Ray Dalio would call a beautiful deleveraging.
Made famous by Bridgewater, I believe, right?
Pardon?
Didn't Bridgewater come up with a beautiful deleveraging phrase, or?
Yes, that's why I was quoting Ray Dalio.
Oh, Ray,
founder.
You quoted Ray. Sorry,
Ray Dalio of Bridgewater calls it a beautiful deleveraging.
Did he copyright that? No.
He should have done that.
Yeah. Let's turn on the other side of the U.S. into a perspective about the old normal. John Rogers from Ariel Capital.
Well, thank you very much. I am very much the old normal person. I'm looking forward to going to, I'm sure a lot of you are, going to Omaha this week to see the Oracle of Omaha at the annual meeting. Talk about how, you know, America's the best place to be and our best days are ahead of us. It's going to be the best time to be born is to be born today in America. So I think that we are continuing to be in a situation where growth is going to be surprisingly good, much higher than the 2% that was already suggested. I think our unemployment rate will one day get underneath 5% again, and we'll get back to sort of more normal, bullish times. And I think we've gotten so anchored in this long period of sluggishness that we can't see a world of really fast-growing GDP and unemployment being very low again. But I'm quite optimistic we're going to get there. I think what's going to help us get there is the housing recovery is so extraordinarily important, not only because housing is such an important asset for Americans, but also, as we all know, all the jobs that go along with it. You know, people, the paint companies, the people that make all the different products that you find in your home, from carpeting to toilets to whatever you need to have. I think that's going to be very, very important as housing recovery. I saw Larry Fink speak last week, and he talked about the importance of the lower energy prices and the lower gas prices and how manufacturing is going to come back to America, and that's going to be an important part of our growth over the next 5 to 10 years. And of course, we have this extraordinarily low interest rate environment along with our modest PE ratios today, so I still think that's going to continue to be really a very strong factor in making stock prices cheap in today's environment. And also, I think also very importantly, as all of you know, there's been an extraordinary risk aversion broadly. The investment committees that I'm on, the ones that I market to, so many people have de-risked. They're so proud of the de-risking. And people have moved money into all the, hedge funds and fixed income and away from traditional equities. And I think that what's going to happen, of course, is people follow the crowd. I'm already starting to see it, that people are starting to feel more comfortable with riskier assets. Slowly but surely, money's moving back toward the old-fashioned equities of yesteryear and some of us old dinosaurs that continue to pick stocks the way we always have. And I think there's also so much money on the sidelines that people don't think about. There's been so much closet indexing, so many people not wanting to be seen as being different than the market today. The pressure to be like everyone else is the greatest that I've ever seen it. And so I think when that cash starts to flow back to the markets, it's going to be a really bullish sign. And I think the recent data of mutual fund assets growing in the last several months is just a harbinger of what's going to happen in the future. So as you can tell, I'm very, very, very bullish. I think you're going to continue to see money flowing into equities, see our economy be stronger than people have anticipated, and I think we're going to get back to the old normal.
And in comparison, you're a fan of the new normal, but you still also think it will be a beautifully leveraging and
I'm in a fairly optimistic point of view, and I do think it's possible we could have a couple of years of growth that would be sort of 3-4%, but I don't believe we're going back to 3%, and you encouraged us to be controversial. So let me put some math out on this and see if John has a response. GDP growth over the long run, and this is not over a 5 or 10 year period, but over, let's say, a 15 or 20 year period, is usually just the sum of population growth plus productivity growth. For a long period in this country, we had population growth that advanced at 1.5% a year, and we were fortunate enough to have productivity growth that, let's say, was 1.5% a year. Thus, you had GDP that could grow at 3% real. Population growth now is now down to 50, 60 basis points, about 0.5% a year. And I think we'd all be delighted to experience productivity of 1.5% a year. Thus, I get to 2%.
You agree with that? Disagree with that? No more than 2%?
No, I think you'll see it'll be surprising. I think you'll get over 4%. And I do think this idea of extrapolating what's happened with our population growth today is not accurate. I think people are, you know, it's been a period where people stopped having kids as much because of the tough recession. People were living, you know, in their parents' basements or attics or whatever and staying home for longer periods of time. But ultimately, people will be moving out as the economy strengthens. People will start to formulate more families, and it's just inevitable. And so I think you're going to be surprised by the growth. There's all this pent-up demand for homes and housing and for the population to grow again. I think people have just extrapolated the past into the future, and I think it's going to be better than we think.
So 2%, 4%, still growth. Mm-hmm. That's all being fueled by the Federal Reserve and this enormous quantitative easing. So let's turn to rates for a minute. John, you guys specialize in the fixed income markets. What's your outlook, and how is quantitative easing going to end?
Well, our outlook is cautiously optimistic. We feel, you know, there's not a double dip around the corner, and the markets are always fearing that. But I do think that an increase in rates is not a bad thing. If we go back to the old normal, what if we had normal interest rates? What we all know is job growth does not come from big companies, it comes from small business. And how easy it is for Apple to borrow money and big companies to borrow money, but small business has no access to capital. And if we had a normal rate, the banks would have an incentive to loan money to small businesses. So we have a low interest rate environment, but small businesses don't have access to capital. And job growth comes from small business. So in my sense, if rates were to go up a bit in here, that is not bad news. This flat yield curve is not doing the job. I think the Fed is pushing up on a rope. Nothing's happening. And if we had more normal rates, what you'd have is the incentive for banks to loan to small business. Small business creates jobs. We're seeing the wealth effect now. Housing prices, it was today a headline, housing prices are going up, but still well below their peaks. But that's a terrific wealth effect where consumers will start spending again. So we're a bit more optimistic on that sense.
Okay. Well, then, Bloomberg is out here shooting live today, and I know most of their discussion this morning has been when FOMC comes out later today, everyone's going to be looking for that hint of when rates would go back up. So you think the Fed could raise rates slowly and it would be received well by the street?
You know, I think so. I think what, if we go back to school, M times V, right? So the Fed can increase M all the time, but V, velocity of money, is spending. So when you look at the chart, M is going straight up and V continues to go down. So they keep printing money, but people aren't spending money. The amount of money is the M times V. And so, no matter how much they increase, if people aren't spending money, it's not working. So we need to see really the consumers start spending again, and they seem to be starting that. I think one chart I saw where V is actually coming up a little bit. I'm kind of in the camp, maybe a little inflation, 2 or 3% inflation is probably a good thing. The Fed has a much better ability to control inflation than deflation. And so having some inflation that they can control is much better than trying to stop deflation is where we're at today.
Okay. So that's kind of our view as a panel on the U.S. Let's expand it out to the rest of the world, which certainly is very complicated today with the picture in Europe and now this suddenly massive run-up in Japan and their easing. George, when you look at the world, do you see relative optimistic outlook to this quantitative
track? I think that there's no doubt that the developed world is going to grow at a slower, sustainable rate going forward. However, just because the average outturn is on average low does not mean that there are not huge investment opportunities, because there is an enormous dynamic within an economy. So we think there are several areas where there are some fantastic long-term growth potential. We've got a number of themes. One of them is mass affluence. That is clearly being driven by the emergence of spending power in the developing markets. Everyone knows about the middle class and the emerging markets. I think that the main point that people have got to understand is that it is so huge. The Western world, which really drove growth in the post-World War II period, has a population of about 750 million. We are seeing multiples of that number that are coming into the consuming classes now. Now, some of the best ways to invest in that are not just with local companies, but with the great branded goods companies in America and in Europe. So despite the fact that Europe is going to have very, very slow growth, and we know what the problems are, we think that some of the companies that are based there are poised for many, many years of great growth. Another thing that's going on in a slow growth world is this this generation of information. The amount of information being generated per year is doubling. In the mobile sphere, it is tripling. And the people that shunt this stuff around, Cisco, Ericsson with its mobile networks, reckon this is sustainable for a 5-10 year period as we move from, you know, for example, an internet of people to an internet of things, and networks get bigger. So slow growth, yes, lots of opportunities to invest, though. The idea is really that people have extrapolated their overall pessimistic, overall view of the world onto markets, and they're not really looking out very far in terms of discounting what's going on. So a lot of growth stocks, although they have moved quite significantly over the last year or two, in our book, are still very cheap. So we are very, very positive on growth equities, and we really don't care where they're based. Having an idea that because Pernod Ricard is based in Paris, and that its ability to sell whiskey and vodka to the emerging world is the wrong idea.
Very company specific, but again, overly cautiously optimistic.
Optimistic, definitely.
Okay. Todd, you've been patient. I want to come back to you. I know you don't believe in the asset classes. You like to look at individual trades. So when you look at this U.S. normal or non-normal world, you look at the global environment, where do you see opportunity, but where do you see risk?
First of all, you said spice it up a bit, right? So just the concept of normal is a relative term, right? So it's sort of like risk-adjusted. Our whole industry uses words like alternatives, risk-adjusted, and so what's risk? It used to be not risky to work at Lehman Brothers, and it turns out it was pretty big career risk. And so we try to think about things like loss-adjusted returns, volatility-adjusted returns, and so on. So the other thing, too, is that whether it's wealth management or investment management, we all seem to drive to a single asset allocation model. I know it changes slightly, but if you look around the universe, within the asset allocation pie, you have terms that don't tell you anything about the behavioral characteristics of assets. So we've all embraced alternatives. So what's an alternative? It's really just a fee structure that often buys things off bank balance sheets that prior to that moment were just a loan. Right, and so it's active management. So we really embrace the notion of active management, tactical management. So normal for me is going to be different than normal for a pension fund, right? Pension funds are guided by consultants and so on. And so an asset allocation model has to have core allocations that say a big family doesn't have to have. There's no rule that says you have to own equity, right? And so we don't really believe in the U.S. equity markets, nor bond markets at the moment, because if you took Fed stimulus away, it'd be hard to argue that either would be as high as they are. So they're sort of zombie markets at the moment. They're all pumped up with steroids. And so rather than prognosticating about where we're going, we would rather look at ways to make money. A friend of mine has a funny but accurate term. He said, you can only outperform your peers in three ways. One, is to inherit money, which is not in my future. Two is to invest in innovation, and let's call that alpha. And three is buying other people's mistakes. So it's harder to find real innovation at the moment. It's not hard to find dysfunction. And I spent 3 hours with the great Myron Scholes the other day, who calls these omega moments. Omega moments are forced liquidations. And so if you just look at the asset bubbles around the world, you have huge dollar surpluses in China and a devaluing currency through time, in our view, that need to go into hard assets. You have $3 to $4 trillion of assets in the Eurozone that need to find a new balance sheet, which would be an omega moment. Will you buy them at 50 cents on the dollar? I don't know, but it's a pretty clear way to make money rather than just predicting GDP. You have oil and gas stocks, you have commodity stocks, gold, copper, iron ore stocks, which are cheaper today than 2009 levels. So if you're an inflationist, holding dollars, holding paper currencies, the world is priced to a deflation. I find it impossible to think that we're not going into an inflation. So a systematic rotation out of paper assets into hard assets, and given where those valuations are, is a very clear way to make money. We may be wrong, but we won't be wrong for forever.
And when you talk about hard assets, for the audience's sake, what's besides gold, what else are you thinking about?
Gold would be my least favorite, but because you don't need gold, you might want gold. It was once a surrogate currency, but you need copper, you need iron ore to run China and other places. You need oil, you need gas, you need water, you need food. And so there are profound mispricings around the world. And so they're not everywhere, but there's enough for this panel to invest its money, put it that way.
Gotcha. All right. I want to, the panel I led last year, as I mentioned, was extremely pessimistic. Other than John, we're relatively optimistic. So my challenge out to you is, I like your phrase of federal, Ben Bernanke is giving the market steroids. We're seeing that in the Bank of Japan, the Bank of England, the ECB. Steroids normally don't end well for people. Let's push on that for a minute in terms of, instead of being optimistic, what are some of the risks out there that could cause you to revise your forecast? Anne, I'm going to go back and start with you.
Okay. I actually think in the near term, I would be more concerned about a downdraft due to weak economic growth, most likely in Europe, but possibly in China or emerging markets, than I would about the effects of the steroids of all the monetary stimulus. I think a year or two from now, we could have built excessive leverage and speculation into the system, but I don't see that yet. Whereas, if you think about Europe, where now Eurozone growth is about zero, and you have countries where the unemployment rate is 25%, the unemployment rate among young people is 50%. I worry more about that over the next 12 months.
Gotcha. John, I'm going to come over to you. You said you would like to see a little inflation and a little rise in interest rates. What if we saw 8% inflation and real interest rates climbing?
Yeah, that would not be good news, obviously. We don't, I remember the 70s very well. I started investing in the 70s, and that's not good news in that situation. But a little inflation is probably better, even from the Fed point of view. I think, you know, when we look at, we haven't talked about, but we need to get the private sector going again. GDP numbers came out to 2% or so. Private sector was 4%. The public sector was small. I just came back from Europe, the same problems there. I was in Greece, they have no private sector left. What they're trying to do now is recreate the private sector by privatizations and everything else. So we have some of the same problems, in my view. We have to get the private sector going again, small business going again, and we can talk about the Fed doing this and doing that, but the fact of the matter is, there's a lot of money on the sidelines. Corporations have a lot of money on the sidelines, and we need to see better government policy so there's a confidence that you can invest in the future. And right now, we're not seeing that confidence that you can invest in the future.
John, you're going to go, you said, to Omaha. Have a nice trip. What a lovely drive or flight to there. But I'm going to challenge you to raise your hand and ask the Oracle. He's been very optimistic, but what are the risks? What do you see as the risks out there for your positive forecast?
I think the risks are the ones that could have a profound long-term impact on our economy, not something like the short-term problematic. So, you know, I think Warren's actually talked about this, you know, the risk of bioterrorism. If there's some kind of extraordinary attack that really impacted the developed markets, it would be a real problem. Of course, also you worry about nuclear terrorism and things that are going on now in North Korea and South Korea and the Middle East, and all these sort of hot points around the world. If somehow it could really get into this, again, nuclear type of a situation, that would be something that would give us great concern here that could really cause our markets to be down for quite a long time. You know, I'm on the board of Exelon, and you know, it's an energy utility, and you start to see the risk that can happen if terrorists did the right thing to be able to attack the power grid and turn the lights out in a major city for a very, very, very long time, or do it for several cities. So those are the types of things that would really worry me. Outside of that, I'm really confident.
Okay. What about your perspective on the rest of the world?
Well, I think investors have got used to Europe being in a bad place and have got maybe a bit complacent about it, so that could flip. But just to emphasize the microeconomic nature of opportunity, Spain is an awful economy with an awful market last year, and the three stocks we own there all went up, some quite significantly, like over 100%. So if the company is doing the right thing and addressing the right type of market worldwide, there is opportunity independent of the economic outlook of the underlying country's economy. What I'm a little nervous about at the moment is the optimism about Japan. The reason I'm a little less optimistic about it is that at the end of the day, if you're going to invest for the very long term, you want a company to take your investor's dollar and turn it into something bigger. That means that you've got to have a decent capital allocation within the company. Now, if you look at the top 200 or so biggest companies in Japan and look at their ability to deliver a return on capital that's more than their weighted average cost of capital, there are about 30 out of the top 200 that have done that on a consistent basis. So we have an endemic problem of misallocation of capital in Japan. So until that problem is solved, I don't think that it's going to be a great long-term investment.
Despite the run-up that we've had, the tremendous rebound in their market?
Well, of course, you know, a lot of people, there's a good trade there on the basis that certain export-oriented companies are going to be massively advantaged versus their competitors in the rest of the world. And, you know, obviously some asset, anything that's asset-backed has gone up too, but that's kind of not really the way that we invest.
Okay, individual specific. So other risks that you see out there, you'd go into hard assets?
I mean, I think the biggest wild card is the Eurozone and some sort of cataclysmic event, a run on a currency. We haven't seen that. So there's always the Cyprus bank scenario that could turn into something else. But again, we don't really think in terms of, we like to say hope is not a strategy. Betting on U.S. policy, for instance, to stimulate small business, I think is probably a bad hope. When there are definitive ways to make money from these great imbalances. And so if you can kind of set your toll booth up next to a multi-trillion dollar imbalance and get your share of assets, you will outperform. And since you're talking about big pools of capital, whether they're insurance companies, banks, pension funds, and so on, if you can simply get 10-15% of your assets to a high single-digit yield, let alone a low double-digit yield, the effect on the return on equity is gigantic. And so that requires tactical, active asset allocation. And rather than worrying about those things that might sink us, I think it's better to set up to get ready for them, because you just have to have these liquidations. You have to. The Eurozone has to delever. And so, you know, people are making senior secured loans now at 15% on real estate transactions. The banking system is closed, and so that would be a very good allocation that we would call a low beta allocation, low volatility allocation that'll give you a very high yield.
So within companies, within countries, you're seeing individual specific trades that you like, and you would avoid sort of the beta entire
index. I don't think you're paid for the volatility. If you look at the S&P for the last 10 years, you've had a volatility of 20-40% with a return of roughly zero. So why would you want more of that? And so you can't convince me that there isn't more of that given how pumped up the stock market is on quantitative easing. And so just betting on stock markets, I'd rather bet on an emerging market where you've had depressed levels, say in Brazil or China. China's slowing down, but there's actual growth. And so betting on the Western economies as a growth story, they're anything but normal. You know, we talk about special situations as a category in hedge fund land. The whole thing is a special situation. So, you know, you can form lots of different strategies around them.
John, you tend to be long only, and you've been one of our managers. You'll probably be one of our managers again at some point. But we ask you to be long only in that mandate. So do you think you should be able to be more tactical, or is it all right to have a beta exposure?
I think it's fine to be long only. And I, as I've said earlier, I think we're going to get back to those days where, you know, the John Neffs, the Peter Lynches, the John Templetons, the traditional long only stock pickers come back into vogue. And we get away from some of the what's happened with the hedge funds have taken, you know, captured everyone's imagination. Everyone thinks you can lower risk, lower volatility, and get greater returns at the same time. And it's some kind of magic potion. You know, I think we're going to get back to normality. And so the idea of being able to just think about buying great companies and owning them for the long run, I know it's been out of favor for quite a long time, but you know, these things come back. And I think we'll have a great long run because of people have just sort of forgotten about that kind of way of making money.
Let me challenge the two of you, and then I'll come back to you guys. You like buying stuff at a deep discount, and that's what gives you comfort that it's a good trade. Normally with a growth manager, we would accuse growth managers of not being as discriminating when it comes to price, just buying it because they think it's going to grow. Is that a contrast, or are you actually pretty similar in terms of looking for discount?
I think that, you know, being a value manager is completely, I think is completely different. I think, you know, you're trying to find a company where there's this bear story out there that makes people uncomfortable, makes people lose confidence, and you can try to find this great business where people misunderstand the long-term potential of the business. And I think that's fundamentally different than being a growth investor, where you are extrapolating growth into the future and buying something and not worrying as much about the price today. So I think it's a totally different mindset that you have and a totally different approach. But it does take a certain personality to be able to buy things that everybody hates and be able to stick with it for time after time, where maybe it disappoints for a period of time, and you have to stick with it until things get back to normal.
And Todd, you'd agree with the idea of buying something people hate, but you'd rather not be held to an asset class.
Yeah, when we talk about distress too, I think the best purchases are actually a misnomer as well. Often the best distressed transactions are caused by distressed sellers, where the assets themselves are not distressed. So if you looked at the loan market in 08 and 09, you're buying senior secured performing debt at 65 cents. So there was nothing wrong with the asset. It was just you had a delevering going on. So that's sort of this notion of an omega moment. The problem with the long on the equity market, and you know, everybody knows Warren Buffett's a genius on the asset side. His real genius is on the liability side. So he has very low cost liabilities, but the amazing thing is that he has no correlation at all to the stock market. So in March 09, he can go out and write an insurance policy and buy the dips. Whereas for the long short universe, the mutual fund universe, and so on, in periods of crisis when you should be buying, they're getting redemptions. And so the notion that $1 trillion exists in the long short universe with a one-year lockup, with the volatility of 20 going to 70 in 2008, so everybody rushes to the door to redeem, and so at the very moment they should be buying the Dow at 6,000, they're having to pay off their investors. So that structure, if Buffett thought that was a good structure, he'd be a 1.5 in 20 fund. But in fact, he's an operating company that can raise money in periods of crisis. So that's my issue with the long only market.
Fair enough. Let's go and talk about from a growth perspective. So are you indiscriminate when it comes to price?
Well, any manager that doesn't pay attention to valuation when he buys a stock is going to get into trouble. Growth strategies that fell flat on their face after the great TMT bubble ended 12 years ago. I mean, a lot of people were buying Cisco because it was the best of breed, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And they're sitting on, if they bought it at the top, which was March of 00, I think, or 01, they're looking at about 80% losses. So if you don't pay attention, you're going to get into trouble. The way I think about growth is that it's very much it's a future orientation, and you believe the future will be different, and that you are extrapolating that different sectors will grow faster, and that there will be a different sort of forced ranking of the index. And you kind of work back from that future view back to a sensible price today. But price is always, always, always important. As a growth manager with our turnover is very, very low. It's about 10% by name, about 20% by value. The key thing is to know what you want to own, those companies that you do think have a great growth trajectory, and then wait for the market to offer up a price at which it is a bargain. So for example, in 2008,
everyone said, well, this is the worst financial crisis of our generation. The sector that will get affected most is the high-end consumer discretionary. So all luxury goods stocks got absolutely walloped, down 40 to 60%. Now, what happened was that the fundamentals were that the Russians, Chinese, Brazilians, and Indians all stepped in. And despite the fact that there were massive decreases in demand in the Western world, the actual average for LVMH, which is the biggest one, Louis Vuitton, its sales were flat that year. So stocks were down 50%. They were a bargain. Many of them were up 6 to 12 times in the intervening four-year period. So you've got to know what you want to own and a price that makes sense to own it over a sensible time period.
All right. And John, I want to turn to you. When you think about purchasing securities, and do you want to own a market and have beta exposure? Do you want to be nimble and be tactical? Obviously, we're all going to agree that price is a critical entry point in any kind of a trade. But when you look forward reading the tea leaves, how would you be an investor? Would you be beta exposure or would you be tactical?
Well, you know, we're in that period in the market, and this is very typical of other market cycles, where the market isn't very forward-looking. When somebody looks at a company and says, well, what's the earnings? You mean next week, right? Next quarter, right? You don't mean 3 years, 4 years down the road. So in these periods, and this is typical of other market cycles, growth is not rewarded very well because that only looks at tomorrow's earnings. Well, when the market starts to get confidence back, they start looking at, oh, let's see now, what's the earnings and the revenue 1 year out, 2 years out, 5 years out? Then all of a sudden, the stocks look very, very cheap. So this is, when you look at growth stocks in here, from a PE, it's less than the market, where it's typically higher than the market. So what you have, you know, everybody says the market's bouncing off new highs, and that, of course, it is. But it's really a two-tier market. The search for yield is in the stock market. So that part of the market is doing very, very well. Growth companies are undervalued. This is the most undervalued we've seen in more than 6 years. So they lag this market rise because of the search for yield. So we feel that the technology stocks and growth stocks in here are very, very cheap because even if you don't have spectacular earnings in here, as confidence sort of rebuilds in here, you'll see PE expansion. And so, you know, from an asset allocation point of view, we would be favoring growth equities in here today. I think a rise in interest rates, the dividend stocks might take the hit there. And growth, if we had a rise in rates, it would be because growth is coming back in the economy. GDP is going up, therefore the Fed feels comfortable in rising rates. Therefore, we think the equities that are very cheap in here, you know, would be growth equities in the market.
Ann, your thoughts?
Great. Let me try to build on something you just said. I think that quality stocks, which are growth stocks that have growing earnings that grow fairly consistently as opposed to, let's call them, zooming earnings, I think they're attractively priced. By our measures, they are not the cheapest they've been in 6 years, but rather they're at moderately attractive levels. So I don't think we strongly disagree on that. My business is one of investing in hedge funds, so most of the time we're trying to stay away from betas, and we're trying to make money either through asset allocation that is oriented towards places where liquidity is rewarded, distressed sometimes is a good example of that, or through security selection. I actually do think that we're coming into a time when security selection is going to be very well rewarded. And let me try to put a quick context on this. Let me do a quick survey of the room. How many people think that the earnings on companies in the S&P grew at a fairly good clip last year? Just a few people. It's too bad we're not using those clickers. A few people are saying yes. As a matter of fact, the dollar earnings of companies in the S&P did not grow last year. They shrunk. And this is actually operating earnings. So this is my friend Cliff Asness would call earnings before bad stuff, before the accountants make you recognize losses. So in fact, after growing strongly since 08, earnings flattened out last year. We were just in the middle of experiencing the third of the last four quarters where companies' revenue has disappointed, where more than half of the companies have had revenue disappointments. So while Wall Street is expecting for earnings on the S&P to go up by over 10% this year, I would be willing to take the under on that bet. I think actually perhaps earnings on the S&P could be flat again this year. And what I believe that means is that there'll be winners and losers. There will be companies that are able to make their earnings projections, and there are people who are currently projecting optimistic earnings who are going to disappoint. So I actually think it's going to be a good time for stock picking.
And you, John, Todd, you said the rest of the panel, Anne's on your side, sort of viewing this as being a market that's got some holes in it. Everybody else a bit optimistic. You called it a zombie market.
Well, I just don't think it's a real market anymore. And if you look at the Treasury market and Operation Twist, it's been more like Operation Strangle. And so they've killed volatility, which on the one hand is probably okay, but the Fed controls the bond market, so it's no longer a market. And so since you hear people say, there's no yield in the bond market, so let's find return in the stock market. And I always say, okay, well, what happens if they go down 30%? So depending on who you are, if you're a foundation, you can't take down 30%. If you're an endowment, you can't take down 30%. So it just doesn't make sense to me. I think it's asymmetric against you when you have these other money-making opportunities that give you real convexity, as we would call it. And just becoming that intermediary for balance sheet in motion, because clearly the world needs new balance sheet. So that's a moneymaker to me, as compared to just betting on the stock market. It doesn't mean that there isn't growth. You know, everybody's taking Apple out to the woodshed. It's still growing at 20% per year, but you know, it's a massively volatile ride. So you'll probably do fine on certain picks, but from a macro point of view, there's no real growth.
You guys are buying stocks. Are you buying zombie stocks?
Am I buying what stocks?
Zombie stocks?
I hope not. If you're prepared to look out further, there are just some fantastic opportunities. You've got to be, don't pay a lot of attention to where the headquarters are. You've got to think of global opportunities. And if you are prepared to extrapolate, there are some significant structural forces out there that are creating really, really good long-term opportunities, and they're just not reflected in the valuation at the moment. I think that there's going to be a bifurcation in the stock market, because I really think that there are, with this average growth, if certain things are doing well, then the corollary is that certain sectors are going to be doing poorly. And I think that in terms of a lot of people who've typically invested in the cycle or a sort of cyclical recovery, or a restructuring story, often that restructuring story needs a bit of a GDP push to get it over the parapet. In this slower growth world, that type of thesis, I think, is a lower probability outcome than it would have been in a much more sort of rapid economy. So I think you've got to pick your spots, and I think that they'll serve one very well. The other thing is that the kind of the mathematics of the way these companies work are really tremendous over the long term, because you've got, let's say a lot of these consumer goods companies had grown to a point where they kind of maximized their market shares in the developed world. And because everyone likes growth, they kind of diversified into adjacent areas, often not very well. Well, now you've got the likes of Nestle and Unilever and Diageo and Pernod Ricard and all that lot, that can basically, they can reinvest in what they do best for the next few decades. And they can deliver very reasonable, sustainable top-line growth. They can pay for that all with cash flow that they generate themselves. They can manage their balance sheet well, and they can pay a 3% dividend yield. So you've kind of got the best of all worlds in some of these cases at the moment. You've got long-term growth, cheap valuation, and a decent yield.
You still think they're zombie stocks?
Well, I just think it's a zombie stock market.
Okay.
But there, you have individual stocks that, that have real growth. And so if you look beyond the U.S., if you look in North America, Canada, which tends to be a resource play, stocks below $1 billion are down, you know, 50, 80%. And so there are tremendous value plays if your research is right, and it fits our thesis that you're going to have a rotation out of paper assets into hard assets. But nevertheless, you can buy very well capitalized companies that have real growth prospects in oil, gas, gold, et cetera, at 10, 20 cents on the dollar. And so we'd rather buy that operating leverage than go buy the ETF.
Gotcha. John, you own zombie stocks? No.
I think we have our favorite areas are, you know, we'd like to try to invest in our circle of competence. And so we have a big exposure to the financial services sector these days. In particular, the alternative investment area has been our favorite area. So our biggest company holding right now is KKR. Hmm. So everybody knows what they do. One of our second largest holdings is Lazard, you know, which does a great job in investment banking as well as emerging markets, mutual funds. We have a lot of real estate related financial services companies from CB Richard Ellis, Jones Lang LaSalle, real estate services businesses that are doing a wonderful job, FICO, First American Financial. There just seems to be bargains, you know, everywhere in that area. And finally, their cheapest one is Western Union. You think about global transfer of money, there still needs to be cash moved from one emerging market to another, and Western Union continues to have the best brand. So we really have big positions, really big believers in these alternative financial services companies.
So I'm going to challenge you guys, and I didn't warn them about this question, but basically everybody here in this audience has a 401k. Probably a fair statement. You're trying to manage it. You're trying to figure out what's your asset allocation. So big picture question, put on your financial planner hat. How would you tell this audience to allocate their 401k over the next year? Roughly how much stocks, US, non-US, how much fixed income? How much water and hard assets? I don't know if we can buy that in a 401k, but we could try. Who wants to go first?
We should make you go first.
Good God. That's fair. I'd say you have to look at your time frame. If you're going to retire in a few years, then you've got a real challenge because you've got to figure out with this Federal Reserve how much you really want in fixed income. But knowing what most people have in their 401k, they've got to look at their equity exposure, balance it between the U.S. and non-U.S., and most people don't bother to read those statements and realize they're over-allocated to stocks. But I think, I know we manage some 401k money and offer it into school districts, and one of the interesting challenges is how do you give it a diverse enough set of options so you can pick from it, because it's really just fixed income and equity options. And if you don't like either, if you want hard assets.
Well, there's no, as you said, there are no real options there. And so the notion of a 401k when you had periods of growth over the last 30 years made sense. In the last 10 years, it didn't make sense. And so I think if you, rather than think about those terms, think about a behavioral profile. If you could pick one behavioral profile, but then you have to sort of go away for 5 years and come back and see how it performed. If you pick stocks, you don't know if you're up 50 or down 50. But if you could find a good current yield with inflation protection, at some point inflation's coming. We're not going to live in a zero interest rate world. And the housing market is already starting to heal, and so we'll just change the rules until we have inflation. We're a consumption economy. So if you can find current yield within capital markets term negative duration, like IOs, that would be the profile. Multifamily buildings have this characteristic. It's current yield, and when inflation comes, the economy heats up, rents go up. It's that sort of profile, because you're living in a zero interest rate environment, and there's still way too much confusion. Right? We don't know what's happening with the Eurozone. We don't know what's happening in Washington. And so that profile, if you could pick it, would be great. But instead, you just get core fixed income, core equity. And so I think 401ks are sort of irrelevant right now.
How does that make everybody feel this morning? Everybody wants to get another cup of coffee. John, you were going to say something.
Yeah, you know, from a 401k, it's really an asset allocation. I would not be ignoring fixed income in here. There is some very good value in the fixed income market, especially in the mid-grade market, the high-quality, high-yield market. You know, we're seeing over 6% coupons with a five-year duration. That market has done well when interest rates went up, so that's very attractive from a fixed income point of view. Long-duration bonds, the governments, we would avoid in here. The other thing that's happened in the fixed income market is enhanced fixed income, which is alternatives, long-short strategies. All those are playing more now into the fixed income asset allocation. So what we see the more institutional type investors doing is not changing their equity allocation so much, but using different enhanced fixed income strategies for the fixed income side of the equation there. Convertible bonds, you know, I started in convertibles in the 1970s. 1970, one of the worst bond markets. Interest rates doubled again. Stock market actually went sideways, very volatile for 12, 13, 14 years. Best performing asset class, convertible bonds. So there are things to do. I don't like the attitude where, oh, I'm going to sell everything, sit around and wait for 5 years and see what happened. You know, look at all the people that sold off in the fourth quarter of 2011. Oh my God, the world's coming to an end. We saw equity, coming out of mutual equity, mutual funds, never came back in. Now they're sitting around waiting, well, when do I get back in? When do I get back in? So I think the asset allocation is really important. I always tell people in your 401k, have enough equity in there so you sleep through the night. If you're worried about it all the time, you gotta look through the near-term volatility, look through that, think like a long-term investor. Don't let the headline be your portfolio manager.
George, you have some thoughts you're going to tell us?
I think you've got to have a mind to what your time horizon is. I think that within the fixed income allocation, you've got to be much more creative. I agree absolutely. Mm-hmm. Alternatives and specific areas of the fixed income market. For clarity's sake, I have 100% of my 401k in my international growth fund.
You're backing yourself. That's so good.
But I think, you know, I think one of the things is that people have got to have a mind to have equities a lot longer than they previously thought. I mean, life expectancy is, you know, around 80. So cashing out into fixed income, particularly with the way the fixed income market is now, is not exactly going to be a guarantee of a great lifestyle for the next 20 or 25 years. So I think people have got to think more about sort of equities through their 60s and longer than that.
Okay. Anne?
Well, it's a better time to be an institutional investor than a retail investor. It may always be a better time, but I think it's a little tougher now, and I'll explain why. I think for most people, holding something like 50 to 60% of your portfolio in stocks, and we could pick a broad index like the All Country World Index as a base place to work from, is not a bad strategy. And to George's point, you know, someone who retires at age 65 may well be looking at a life that will go on another 25 years or so. So they have a long enough time horizon that holding fairly hefty amounts in stock can be quite appropriate. But then the problem would become, what do you do with the other 40 to 50% of the portfolio? In the old normal times, you could probably just put it in a mix of fixed income and cash and feel okay about that. Now that's really tough because, I'd have to look at what the yield on the Lehman, now Barcap Ag is. Chris, maybe you know, it's probably 1.5.
Yeah, I would say 1.7 is off top of my
head. 1.7, something like that. And that doesn't really work for people. For institutional investors have the opportunity to pursue more income-oriented strategies, and we've talked about that some here, some things like middle market lending, some selective high-yield type of investments. Those are less available to individuals, and I grew up in the fixed income market, And I get scared when people use the word enhanced fixed income, because sometimes that's a code word for meaning we've dressed something up for you that looks like it has more yield, but it will really hurt you someday. And Chris knows where I speak, because he also started in fixed income and cash. As to the high yield market, I'll spend 1 second on that. I think the yield on the high yield index right now is 5.7, which is an all-time low. I do think that means that it's going to be relatively hard to find non-investment grade bonds of fairly good quality that will yield 6%. I actually think the better quality ones may be yielding 3 or 4%. That does not mean that's a terrible thing to do. I think the thing to understand about the great deleveraging, about financial repression, is that at the end of the day, in order to solve the debt problems that we have built up, interest rates need to be very low, and that means low returns for savers. And unfortunately, in this new normal, a lot of people may need to adjust to a place where very well-constructed portfolios may only make them something like 4%. And I know that's depressing news, but it may be the world that we live in.
No, that's fine. John?
Well, I agree with this idea that everyone's going to be living longer than people expect. I do think this audience, we spoke specifically about this audience, I think most of us love being in financial services and will continue to work into our 70s. And I can see a lot of that in the audience here. So I think for that reason, I would have 90% in equities, very, very, very little in fixed income. You can tell from my comments today, I'm very, very bullish about the future. And I always remind myself of what Warren talks about and talked about in this year's annual report, that the 20th century, you know, the Dow went from 66 to over 11,000. And that was a period where you had four costly wars, the Great Depression, several recessions, presidential assassinations, and the market still went from 66 to 11,000. So I think if you take that long-term perspective and point of view, you can invest in your 401k with confidence and not worry about the short-term ups and downs.
Well, one of the challenges is, maybe some of you went to the panel, I missed it, on how to live to 1,000. I'm not sure I want to live to 1,000, but
how to keep
the duration
job.
Of that, yeah, the duration of that asset pool is very long. So in our last 15 minutes, my challenge to you is think forward to 2016. Bernanke has said at that point he should be unwinding things. Is the stock market, most of you, I'm going to assume, are going to say the stock market is higher in 3 years than it is today. But where are we with interest rates? And more importantly, where are we with inflation? And Todd, I'll start with you, because I think it's obviously you've got the most dire outlook.
I don't know if it's dire. I think it's an amazing opportunity. But I think that, you know, the notion of having so much money allocated to equities is the very thing that's giving daily panic attacks to baby boomers, who are now the oldest baby boomers, whatever, 67 years old, and they put this trade on, and suddenly they have a zero IRR for 12 years. And so now the good news for them is that they're going to live till 80, so keep that trade on, I think, is just a horrible idea. And so personally, I probably have about 5% of my money allocated to equities and the rest to other situations. So it's impossible for me to think that with the level of quantitative easing here and in the Eurozone that you don't have a reflation. That is our goal. If you really tell the truth about our liabilities, the US is insolvent and so is the Eurozone. So we have to devalue our liabilities and so we have to print inflation. And so if the history of inflation is that it comes without warning and it comes in a violent way. If you go back to 1973, CPI was 0.3 per month until I think it was August 1973, and the nominal print was 7% in 1 month. Well, nobody understood that, but the prior 10-year period had a huge run-up in the money supply. So it's just a time bomb ticking, and when it comes, it's going to come violently. And I don't think the Fed will be so adept at putting the genie back in the bottle. As we were talking before, in 1994, suddenly it was Greenspan raised rates by 75 basis points, not 25, and he kept doing it. And so that crushes the carry trade. And so we don't know where this one's going. And so I think given where we are in the world and given that we're priced to a deflation, including on the natural resource side, it's a very good time to rotate there. The levels are so cheap, you can afford to wait. In many cases, it's not a negative carry trade. In other words, when you shorted subprime, it was a negative carry trade for a year or what have you. There are actually a lot of positive carry trades. So if you can find a positive carry trade, a current yield trade that gave you inflation protection, I'd be focused there. But too much equity exposure, and the problems that has caused for the baby boomers. Look at our U.S. pension deficit, $4.5 trillion, based on the exact same thinking. There's no yield, so let's find it in the stock market. Last year, or was it 2011? Another $200 billion was thrown on the heap. Thankfully, we had a rally last year. But I mean, this is a hopeful strategy that could get a lot worse.
2016, where do we land, John?
Well, we're like, I guess I'm cautiously optimistic, and I think we'll be coming out of this. Obviously, I think the differences may be, especially for U.S. investors, I think they need to think more globally than ever before, because we're in such a global world. It's good news, bad news. From an investor point of view, you can go anywhere in the world to invest. And we're going to have countries make mistakes, policy mistakes, and capital will go to where it's treated best. Investors will go to where it's treated best. So the growth of the middle class around the world is a phenomenal, a longer-term trend. So when we start thinking out long-term, which companies, which multinational companies are accessing and getting their revenue stream from the growth of the middle class around the world? That's one of the focuses of investments. I think there's too many people that focus on, do you like Europe or do you like the U.S.? We like the company. Where is their revenue stream coming for is more important than where their headquarters are. So we're looking at companies that have revenue streams. It could be a French company, which obviously France is in a very poor, but 90% of the revenue stream is coming from somewhere else. So, from that point of view, it's going to be more complicated investing, but I'm a bit more positive. We can't bet on the Fed solving all our issues. So we'll continue to think more globally. Global equity will probably be the investment strategy rather than just U.S. equity or European equity. It'd be much more global oriented.
And Ann, you've made it clear, a slow, new normal environment, but Where's inflation?
Right, well, since John just gave an equity forecast, I'll give a fixed income forecast.
Okay. That's a
deal.
For
the US. So in 2016, Bernanke will not be the head of the Fed. He steps down in 2014, sooner than we think. So based upon my expectation that growth will be slow over the next few years, 2 to 3%, that we are at a new normal, and that the Fed probably will start unwinding, let's say in 2015, quantitative easing, mostly by just letting their portfolio run off, not by selling things. I suspect that inflation will be in a 2 to 3% range. If John Rogers is right and I'm wrong, then inflation will be higher if growth is stronger. But if I'm right about growth, inflation will be 2 to 3%. And therefore, I think Fed funds policy, when we get to a normal level, will maybe be 3 to 4. It'll be between 0 to 100 basis points above inflation. And therefore, I think the 10-year U.S. Treasury, which is now maybe, 180 or so, might be in a 4.5 to 5.5% range. But I think of it as being about 150 basis points over wherever the Fed funds rate. Where the Fed funds rate is on kind of a three-year moving average.
And by the way, when that occurs, PEs will be 20. That's history at the normal level.
20 on GAAP earnings or 20 on operating earnings? 20 on operating earnings might be 15 or 16 on GAAP earnings.
Okay. Gotcha. John, do you think you're going to have inflation in 2016, or are you going to have a perfect world?
Okay. I think as we look out into the future, there's got to be some consequences for all the decisions of the Fed and what we've had to go through to get out of this horrible almost depression that we went through in 2008 and early 2009. So there will be consequences. Inflation will be significantly higher by 2016. But I do think that the market has time to adjust to that. And I think that PE multiples can go higher. So I'm not too worried about it. And I think it's so highly signaled. Everyone knows what's going to happen. So I think the markets typically collapse when it's a big surprise. I don't think you'll have a collapse because of what is a clearly signaled change in Fed policy as time goes forward.
Globally, you've got Bank of Japan, Bank of England, ECB, and the Fed all unwinding. It actually goes well everywhere?
I actually have no idea. I don't, that doesn't sort of inform the investment process. I think in terms of the way I look at the world, you know, Japan is hoping that they get some inflation. I'm not sure that it makes a great equity investment opportunity. But sort of globally, I don't, you know, I sort of think of one way to look at inflation is that it's a seller's market. The seller is able to command a higher price for whatever good or product they have. And there is a surplus of just about everything. So it's very, very difficult to see where the pricing power is going to come through. That includes commodities. I mean, I grew up in the 70s when the Club of Rome was predicting that we'd be out of everything by now at least. The Earth's crust is full of, is just an amazingly bountiful thing. And it's the only thing that prevents, it's all a question of the cost of extracting it and the technology that we apply. So I think in a world where there's been a lot of investment in accessing commodities, where we've got shale gas technology, and where China's slowing down, that's certainly not a recipe for a tight market in that area either.
All right. Flash round. 2 minutes left, 5 minutes left on the clock. What would you recommend to the audience as your best long, and what would be your best short that they put on tomorrow? John?
Wow, that's a tough one. I think that my number one short would be a company like Clorox. Coca-Cola could be there, Procter & Gamble, but I use Clorox as sort of a signal of the very conservative, low-risk, consumer-branded goods company that people have decided are the end-all and be-all because they have such consistent earnings growth. But these PE multiples for those kind of companies, I think, have grown way outside of bounds relative to the expected growth rate of their earnings. So I think these PE multiples can't be justified just because they've been consistent and they've done well recently. I think you're going to have a much tougher time outperforming the market over the next 5 years. If I had to pick, you know, as I earlier said, KKR is my favorite stock. It's our largest position. And I believe that, you know, Steve Kaplan, the professor at the University of Chicago Business School, talks about all the data that shows that, you know, private equity has outperformed over the long run, and particularly the larger companies have outperformed the best, the well-established brands. And I think KKR will be able to build a global brand in private equity, add some extra products along with it. And so it's something that I think is going to do very, very well. So that would be my favorite long.
Todd?
This may not surprise you, but my favorite long would be natural resources led by oil and gas. And my favorite short would be paper assets led by currencies.
All right. George?
I would, with a long-term view, be very, very keen on sort of the world's leading consumer-branded products. I'll just pick out Diageo. We own that one. Diageo is London-based. Its most famous product is Johnnie Walker whiskey. The potential for sales into emerging markets is vast. 1 in 3 bottles of whiskey consumed in the world is consumed in India. At the moment, the amount of decent scotch that they buy is...
I thought that was Kentucky. I'm shocked.
Scotch. So the potential for many decades of growth is huge. There is huge branding power. There are enormous barriers to entry because Scotch is by definition an aged product made in Scotland. So, but that is just an example of one big global consumer company that we would be owning. I don't have, as I said before, I'm not particularly convinced by Japan because of the capital allocation issue. And I think that investing in any European financial institution is a bit of a shot in the dark because there is a very, very unpredictable regulatory structure. They haven't recapitalized to the extent that they need to. And, you know, the cross-holdings of all these sovereign bonds are a large, unpredictable issue.
Anne?
Okay. Well, I don't disagree with you on global franchises. I think globally strong companies that sell to consumers are, you know, have the power to grow for a long time. But I might pick mid-market lending as my favorite long, something that can earn you high single digits or low double digits by filling this gap between bank lending and companies that actually can profitably employ capital at 8 to 10% to make profits. That would be my favorite long. If I could pick my favorite short, it would be to find an industry that was going to be the next newspaper industry that was just destined for structural decline. And so if I could identify those people who were going to be losers at the hands of the rise of the new online courses, the MOOCs, that might be my favorite short. But absent that, I think I might, if I were permitted to buy credit default protection on the French sovereign, I think that has some nice asymmetry to it.
Interesting. John?
Well, I can agree with George. I would be really taking advantage of the growth of the middle class around the world and looking at consumer brands there as a long-term investment, and I think those continue to do well. On the short side, I'd be very worried about long-dated bonds there, so that would be the short, would be the long-dated bonds, because interest rates are going to go up in here. The problem is we just don't know when, and usually when it happens quickly. A lot of people are in a naive notion that it'll go up nice and gradually, and they'll be able to reallocate slowly as it goes up, but what we've known from history, that's not what happens. Usually there's an event, interest rate spike, and that. So other than that, I'm cautiously optimistic.
Yeah. No, well, I am pleased to say that I am very confident this year compared to last year that this panel is correct, because you had two points of very different points of view. You know, it's going to end badly and you need to be in hard assets, or it's growth. It's going to be slow growth or it's going to be fast growth. So one of us is going to be right, one of us is going to be wrong, and that's the way the markets work. You need two people on both sides of the trade. So please join me in thanking the panelists for sharing their ideas. Thank you.